Hello, welcome to Off the Press, the program where we dissect the headlines and try to make sense of it and understand it. And of course, with me to do so this morning is a political commentator, Femi Idowu-Adegoke.
Good morning.
Good to have you. And policy analyst Ife Oji.
Thank you very much.
Good to see you all this bright and beautiful morning. So we have many papers here, all of them almost having the same headline, which I know you know, so your guess is right. Let's begin with the Punch newspaper this morning. It will be displayed. POS agents slam 50 naira charge, operators protest. That's on page 25. Minimum wage, national state councils meet on negotiations on Tuesday. That's on page 7. Now, court adjourns Ambode's probe suit against assembly, and you find that story on page 9. The paper is upside down. And then the big story there is Atiku loses, APC mocks PDP, opposition attacks judiciary, on page 2. Now, Supreme Court in 3 sentences throws out Atiku's appeal. Stop destructive agenda, APC tells PDP. Judiciary sabotaged by dictatorial cabal, ex-VP says so. And that story is on page 2. Now, governors raising private security outfits, Gani Adams alleges. And that's on page 13. Court refuses transferring Maina's case to another judge on page 7. And then we have a picture story there of pupils and a building of TD Primary School, Burak, pictures 1 and 2, which you can see, and pupils of Faring Kasa Primary School in Shongom local government area of Gombe State during lessons. You can imagine the state of that school there. I hope it be displayed. You'll get to see the pictures again of a school that is quite in a deplorable condition there. And then we'll challenge Okoro-Cha's senatorial seat to Supreme Court, according to INEC. On page 18, and the first Lagos military governor, Mobolaji Johnson, dies at 83. God rest him there. You find the story also on page 6 of the Nation newspaper. Traffic violation, Lagos to auction 53 seized vehicles. That's very serious. And you find that story also on page 4. EFCC invades Ogun Varsity's poly and abducts students. EFCC abducts students. That's on page 11. It will be displayed. A motorcyclist, passenger, pupil crushed to death in Lagos, Ogun. That sad story is contained on pages 4 and 5 of the Punch newspaper. And finally, gunmen kidnap another Edo judge and kill the elderly on page 10. So where do we begin this morning? The big story, Atiku loses, APC mocks PDP. Any thoughts on that? Which do you want to start with?
Well, we can start from there.
It's almost, the road is ended, yeah, it's because, closed now.
Yeah, Nigeria's, the Supreme Court is the apex court of the land, so I guess we'll rest now and we'll go back to governance. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, PDP shouldn't cry foul.
Why did you say so?
They managed the affairs of this country for 16 years and did nothing, virtually nothing, to strengthen our institutions. So they are part of whatever they are accusing APC of. So that's my take on that. Just leave it and let's move forward.
We have to move on anyways. Any thoughts on that, Ife?
I don't know if I would necessarily agree with Doctor this morning. Yes, they are all part of the larger system, political system, but I mean, I know, for example, like FDI was definitely up during PDP
regime.
And I also know that a lot of our moribund assets were privatized, at least majority of them were privatized during the with the Bureau of Public Enterprise, during the PDP regime as well. And even though, yes, it wasn't perfect, and please, I just want to state out there that I do not carry brief for any political party. I do not belong to any political party. But it's important to also, you know, note things that were actually gotten right, even if they are not so many. At least they still exist.
There were some, at least. Okay, so we'll move on from there. Which other story is catching our attention? What do you think about this primary school in this day and age, really? Even the pictures.
Well, there are 1,001 schools
like this that
across the country.
Unfortunately. So how do we?
We blame the federal government, but this school is situated in a local government, and there is a suburb and whatever name they call the agencies that are in charge of such things. Because really, we as citizens, we don't ask questions. We don't even know our right. We don't even know what we're supposed to do. Because everything drops, we keep blaming or pointing fingers at the center. Whereas such primary school in that local government has a local government authority that is supposed to be in charge.
Mm-hmm.
What were they looking? Yeah, you can see that the school is dilapidated. It's not one day, it's been over time.
They are literally outside.
Yeah, and they are studying now under the tree.
So if it rains, they can't,
they can be no school. They go back home.
Which is unfortunate, I mean. Yeah.
And then it brings us back to the statistics that we have 10, almost 10 million people out of school.
Mm.
You can't be studying under this kind of condition and you want to go to school.
I think he makes a good point. Doctor makes a good point. And I would also want to just, if I may add to what he's saying as well, it's really appalling in terms of, even from a budgetary perspective, how much we spend from a welfare state, for our welfare state. 200 million was spent annually, I think, last year. For 300 million was spent on education last year, and 400 million was spent on healthcare, and that is appalling for a country that has 200 million people.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do the yes, exactly. So you're saying one naira per person. Basically, that's what it basically comes down to. So how do you expect to bring out or have the outcome favorable if you're not willing to invest in your people? So it's a big problem. And also, but I also, beyond that as well, I think, let's just, we've looked at the problem, we know the problem, but we should also look at, try and look at possible solutions for the future. I know, for example, over the weekend, one of the banks, I will not name who they are, had a huge fair for education.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Education 360. And one of the take homes from the fair I attended was that you can have classrooms within walls and beyond the walls. So it was even looking at the idea of, okay, having a virtual classroom.
New form of education.
New form of education, because we have to move with the times. There are going to be many, many, unfortunately, this is just one of many, I'm sure, many examples across the country of classrooms that are just like that.
Mm-hmm.
So the question remains, how do we solve that problem in real time? Not in 20 years' time, not after we've done an endowment fund and try and have a private sector help. Intervention, exactly. Thank you, doctor. How do we have real time? We're living in an age of real time.
Sure.
How do we have those kind of solutions to move forward for the next decade?
Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, this is going to have a direct bearing on the outcome. How do you expect them to learn a thing in this kind of condition, first and foremost? And how do you expect... But yeah, some people, you can argue that, oh, it does not matter where you study if you're bright. But the situation, the condition also should
It's also a testament. Yeah. I know it's really appalling, but also a testament to Nigerian spirit.
Resilience.
It's a resilience. And it shouldn't have to be tested, our resilience.
It shouldn't.
It should not have to be your right. Yeah. But it still also speaks to how resilient we are.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so EFCC invades Ogun University and abducts students. Isn't that worrying? If you can see your eyes, like, why are they going after students now, would be the question. Did you get a chance to?
EFCC might have gone to the university to arrest students. They must have acted on information.
Mm.
There are students, from what we've heard, that are involved in cyber crimes.
Mm.
So if the only challenge I have is abducts students.
Yeah, I know.
It comes to the media again.
Spin doctoring is what I would say.
Mm.
Yes. Yeah, you cannot say abducts because it's like now they just come in and just bundle them.
That's what it's saying.
It makes the students come out, appear as victims.
Mm.
Yes.
We all know they're fully fledged adults, the age of 18 at least, the ones that are up age 18 and above.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And they should be fully accountable for their actions.
Mm-hmm.
And I also feel like we look at the details as well, just even the contextual background. There was a period before my period, but not so far before my period, when 419, if you were not on campus and you were not a 419er and you did not have the big cars and, you know, the big, and it was glamorized at the university level. And
yeah,
so
true.
This is, I guess this is their own way of trying to tackle that social
scourge. I know
scourge.
What that is.
Yes.
Anyway, maybe because we are always seeing kidnappers abduct and suddenly this abduction finds its way into this paper. Anyways, what are your thoughts? Anyway, this is just me trying to find out. This Lagos auctions to auction 53 six vehicles, those who violated the traffic. Is that going to solve the problem, really?
Well,
do you think?
Before they get to auction, I think I'm aware of the part of the laws. There are fines. It's when you don't pay your fines at certain time that you go. And that's
53
it.
Vehicles.
Yeah, it's a global practice.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't pay your fine, then the state cannot be paying to keep your car.
Do you think that will serve as a deterrent even for drivers?
For me, it's a punitive measure.
Mm.
And like we've said before, we have laws, but we don't enforce and we don't give punishment to people. So if you do that and your car is there and you're not paying your fine,
just know that it can be sold to anyone.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm. All right. We'll go to the Nation newspaper now in the interest of time. And again, the story, the big story there, just as it's looking at me, is Atiku, end of the road. It's on the front page there. And it's continued on page 4. And at the top is Court Halts Ambode's Probe. Again, it's on page 44. House Bars Lawyer. And Gunmen Kidnap Appeal Court Justice in Edo. And that's on page 7. And his orderly was shot dead. And the former Lagos Governor Johnson dies at 83. Sonwulu mourns him. That story you find on pages 5 and 41 of the Nation newspaper. And then we have Maina paid 3 billion naira, opened 12 accounts in my bank, says witness. Then there's a picture story. And then Nigeria-US trade hits $5.21 billion. Musa, and that's on the front page, tiny there, but it's continued on page 11. Musa back for Benin and Lesotho. That's also there, continued on page 47. Buhari okays Saudi pact on page 5. And then Brexit, UK leaders clash. That's on the foreign news, but on for page 45 of the Nation newspaper. Again, Ify, which one do you want to start with this morning?
Let's look at the trade between the United States and...
How did I know you were going to start from there?
I can't, I mean, it's very, I mean, I love to talk about
trade
and policy, exactly. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, we all know about the Africa Growth and Opportunity Act that was established in 2000.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, it's had a stop and start kind of... a presence in Nigeria specifically. And obviously with America having major trade wars with China and China going to bed with Russia,
mm-hmm.
we are basically out in the cold, for lack of a better word, with America or the United States of America. So I feel that they're obviously going to make, trying to court us and woo us and try and get a better incentives
mm-hmm.
for us, for our local manufacturing for export. But again, we have to also ask ourselves, even though that it says the headlines are slightly misleading because actually we're down about 32% in terms of what the trade is. So even looking at that figure, the figure looks big, but if you think about it in real terms, that figure should really be 200% higher than what it actually is right now. And again, I think this statement was made, correct me if I'm wrong, at the Lagos Chamber of Commerce and Industry, International Investment Forum.
Mm-hmm.
So what I'm basically trying to say is that we need to put more incentives. I think Ms. Piangelo said it best.
Yeah, it's attributed to her, you're right.
Yeah, so she said it best, that we must make sure we continue to incentivize our local non-export producers and make sure they have the best incentives before we even begin to start closing borders
mm-hmm.
or what have you. Make sure it's completely incentivized because it's such a wasted opportunity in terms of revenue for the country and obviously to boost economic growth for SMEs as well.
Mm, thanks for shedding that light there, Ify. All right, again, we will not talk about the end of the road. So we'll move on. We'll leave that and move on. And then there's a story on kidnap, and then there's something on court halt Ambode's probe. Which one do you want to go for this morning?
Well, before I would like to talk about Ambode, but let me quickly talk about the the Mobolaji, Sir Mobolaji Johnson,
God rest
that
him.
Passed on. God rest his soul.
Amen.
But there is one thing I want to mention. He served as the first military administrator of Lagos State between 1967 and 1975.
That's correct. Mm-hmm.
And then it's worthy of mention for our listeners and our leaders to take a cue from such a man.
Mm.
Because when Muritala Mohammed came in 1975,
mm-hmm.
there was a probe of all the governors. And he and one other governor, they were the only two that were found of no corruption.
Oh, wow.
So I think we need, these are the kind of things that we should put out there so the young coming Nigerians, we know that it's possible to be in public office and not practice corruption or encourage corruption.
So the incorruptible governor, so to speak, it was.
Exactly. And don't let us forget, it was under the military.
Yes.
So
it was the first military
he would have
governor.
Paid if he was found wanting anyway. Mm. So back to Court Alt Ambode's probe.
Well, it's been going and going.
I've always said it. This Lagos State House of Assembly, I've always been quiet.
Do you think so?
Yeah, they've always been quiet. So there is sort of belief that this could be a political witch hunt on Ambode.
Some people have said that.
But because he's come out now, he's going to secure a court ex parte. I'm not a legal practitioner, but I've read that, and this is being, they've asked the State House of Assembly to remain as status quo. And they're going to do some finding because he's claiming those 800 and something bosses were purchased with due process, were properly appropriated for. So we're waiting to see because the court has adjourned the sitting till sometimes in November. So we're here to
see where that takes us.
Yeah.
Okay. Ify, any thoughts on the kidnap again? Yet another justice. It's scary if they have if people in such places of authority are being kidnapped. It begs the question: how about the ordinary person?
It means just because we don't respect authority in this country. it's plain and simple. We don't respect authority. We have found pervasive ways to quietly protest the conditions in this country. But I know that because people typically criticize Nigerians, general consensus that Nigerians typically are not insurgents. There's normally going to be an uprising. But this is a clear way in which they are showing that they did not respect authority.
And there's almost nothing you will do, so to speak.
Yeah. Mm.
But again, it's also worrying the state of security in our nation, you know, if this can happen.
I agree with you, Amaka.
Yeah. Okay. May God keep us safe as we do our best. Okay, so I'm trying to move fast the papers in the interest of time. And then we have just this day. You have something
to do with that.
Okay, sorry. In the interest of time, you can leave it tomorrow. So we just talk about this day. We have this day here. And analysts anticipate stock market rally after OMO restriction. Treasury bills auction records of 43 billion naira over subscription on demand pressure. That story is on the front page. It's continued on page 8, as you can see. And then gunmen abduct appeal court judge in Edo. That story is also there on page 5. Investments on their minds. That's a president. You can see him there with the King Salman. King Salman bin Abdulaziz of Saudi Arabia yesterday. In swift judgment, Supreme Court dismisses Atiku's appeal. Buhari, it's time to move on. And of course, the story of the late Mobolaji Johnson, God rest him, on page 9. That's all we have really on this story. Do you want to? What's that on your Vanguard? Do you want to see? Is there anything? Well, we can leave it in the interest of time. And then on the back page is, column by Olusegun Adeniyi, who says Buhari and the firewall economy. Please grab a copy and know what it is about. And then we have copies of the Complete Sports also, which would ask you to please grab copies for yourself. Okay, firewall. Thank you. I've just been corrected that the name is Buhari and the firewall economy. Thank you very much. What does it mean?
Smuggling.
Oh, smuggling. Okay, so that's what it translates to.
Yeah, firewall is smuggling.
Oh, I see. Okay, so grab a copy of this day and find out what it is about. I'm going to say thank you, Dr. Ido, and of course, Ify. Thank you very much. It's always good to have you here and to help us make sense of the headlines and the newspapers. So we encourage you, of course, to get copies. this to yourself and find out in details. We'll do this again tomorrow at the same time here on Plus TV Africa. I am Amaka Okui. Have yourself a great day.